statement of Jesus when he gathered his children, his disciples, I would say, and they went to Samaria. And he went to Samaria. If you look on John chapter 4, I invite you to open with me. John chapter 4. You'll find out then, Jesus went to Samaria together with disciples, and then he met the Samaritan woman. One individual who tried to deny his frustration that he has no husband. Remember that one? When he asked, "Give me a drink." For he said, "If you know the gift of God and who is that you ask for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." And Jesus said, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water, what? Will never thirst. And indeed the water I give will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Then the woman said to him, "Sir, give me water so I don't want to get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." 17, "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You're right when you say you have no husband. The fact you have five husbands, and the man you know that is not your husband, what you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you're a prophet. One soul on that day." You know what happened? He brought his whole community. He brought his whole community. Verse 39. "Many of the Samaritans from the town believe in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his word, many more become believers. Look at that one. So your personal testimony is a wonderful thing to what? To share to people. The personal testimony is not when I was like that, no. Personal testimony is, what was my life before I met Jesus? What happened when I met Jesus? And what was my life after I met Jesus? Was there a radical transformation? I didn't say, "How long have you been Seventh-day Adventist now?" You may be 50 years and a Seventh-day Adventist, if your life been changed, you haven't met Jesus. The point here is, what changed, what radical change happened in my life, in your life, when we met Jesus? I will not tell you, saying to you, when I was a little boy, I said to my mom, "Mom, when I grow up, I don't like to be a Seventh-day Adventist." You know why? Because of a lot of don'ts. You're going to do this, you're going to do that. And what is fun in being a Seventh-day Adventist? But it changed my life when I get to know him as my personal friend and Savior. We have a small group called Youth Activities. For the first time, we have a spiritual retreat. And we open the Word and we open the Spirit of Prophecy, steps of Christ. You know, being an only child, I found out that Jesus could be a special person I could talk to. I could address whatever feelings I had. If I had a problem, I could talk to him. So it changed my view of being a Christian. From then on, I said, I would like to what? To pursue a ministry. Because I know I'm not worthy, but Jesus will make something out of me. So we studied last quarter the fruit of the Spirit. But don't worry about the fruit. The main thing we need to do is to abide, and the fruit will be a natural outcome. That's what Jesus wants you to understand. So he said, "Behold, I will say to you, I lift up your eyes after them." Yes, you may have one individual, have your personal testimony, but people will hear how your life been radically changed because of Jesus. And people will say, "See God's goodness in his life." Remember, Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before what?
Before men.
Before men, that they may see your what? Your good works. And glorify yourself? No. Glorify your Father in heaven." So we are doing good works because what? For our own glory. And the good works of man comes from him also. hear what people around you. You don't go across the sea to be a missionary. Mom and dad at home, that's the very first missionary area. And as you go out from the neighborhood, go out in the city, that's our missionary. So Jesus said, "Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for the harvest." Who said it?
Jesus.
How many years ago? More than 2,000 years ago. Have you ever realized that one? So my prayer this morning, that God will open our eyes so that we can see His harvest. Whose harvest? God's harvest, not mine. Look at Virginia Beach area. I tried to inquire about the zip code 23450, 23460, and called Iris Reading and Voice of Prophecy. Said, "Would you tell me how many people in this zip code have been in your study, listening and watching Iris Reading?" You know, I received this. Here's what they did. They gave me 70 interest rich. Look at this. If we could invite those 70 people here, we realize that one. They have gone through a study of Iris Reading. Search for certainty. They've been to a study of Daniel Revelation. They finished this Discover Bible lesson. For what they're waiting for? They're waiting for you and for me to invite them to be here. I believe that this is the reason why Brother Danny, Mr. Ida, your minds brought together that this is the place where people could see that this is the place where they could be together ready for the harvest. I wouldn't be surprised if sometime in the future we may have two worship services. And that's my prayer for Virginia Beach. Because there is a reason why God brought you to be here. As a church, I know we've been in what? Existing how many years ago? And we organized as a church, rather than 20-something. God could do after 20-something years. But He's just waiting for you. That's why this is God's harvest, not ours. God is just waiting for you and for me to look for those people seeking the lost. And as Elijah read that scripture, remember? There are three kinds of people who are lost. The lost coin, the lost sheep, and what?
Prodigal
son. They are waiting. Well, you may say they are also lost within us. Well, it's time for us to bring them back. That's why Charlie just gave me the list of our members. Let me share this one to you. We have our membership in the list, 127. 27 of them are active, inactive. 6 are missing. Shall we just close our eyes up and forget them? Let's move on with this. No. We cannot just close our book with that. It's also a responsibility to look for them because they are precious souls that Jesus came for this world. God's harvest. The harvest is truly great. And He is inviting us. I want you to take a look at this. This was written 100 years ago. A Tribune Herald, February 4, 1904. Ellen White, Evidences of Discipleship. Just bear with me. Here's what it says. "The fields are white already for the harvest. The Lord desires more to go out into the harvest field. He will be those who study His word and obey His commands. He will impart to them His grace. Go forth in the name of Christ, remembering that He is your companion, that every prayer, every word, every song is heard by Him. The message of the soon coming of the Lord with power and great glory will bring conviction to many hearts." I was looking for Sister Naomi this morning. Not feeling good, probably.
She's in Richmond.
But every Thursday, What a privilege for me to sing. As Chaplain Mike leads the Bible study, Joe can tell us, Alvin can tell us, and Sister Daphne is there. How many poor people attend? You could take a walk from here, right? If our houses would be like that, I'll be willing to spend much time reading Bible study. Because there are precious souls waiting. And the grandmother was saying, I grew up many years ago in a Christian church, but I didn't know this. There are a lot of questions to the daughter and the grandchildren. So people are waiting for us. Aside from the 17 potential interests that we're looking after, oh, voice of prophecy, and it is written. There are some in our neighborhood, in our community. Remember Mark 16? Where's our young people? When you start doing some play at the nursing home? I'm so curious, how many more nursing homes and assisted living facility here? So I asked Mike. I said, Mike, tell me, how many more nursing homes and assisted living facilities in Tarija? He said, 10. Whoa, 10. Tell me, who am I going to ask? Me. So Mike was the one, so I wrote him. Send me how I could get in touch with those people. And don't worry, it's not us only. We involve Tidewater. We informed our pastor from Norfolk, Pastor Boyd. Pastor Matt from RGM, Redeeming Grace. And I requested Pastor Richard. Why don't we have a community outreach? So look at our avenues of potential witnessing. There are a lot of ways. God is just waiting for us. That's why we could say, as what Revelation says, soon and very soon, we will see the coming King. Soon and very soon, there will be no more sorrow, no more trouble of this world. And Jesus wants us to be ready. I want you to look at this, Revelation chapter 9. Revelation chapter 9, let's start reading. I invite you to open your Bible. The reason why I didn't put the whole text for you to follow me and read the verse. Okay. Revelation chapter 9, 7, verses 9, I would say to God. Okay. And this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude, that no one could come from every nation. Tribe, people, and language standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes, were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, verse 10, salvations belong to our God, who sits in the throne and to the Lamb. Verse 11, all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen. Praise and glory and worship and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Where they come from? From different parts of the world. Soon and very soon, we will see the coming King. The harvest truly is great. Let me tell you this one. And it will be an honest confession to you. I am privileged to be in the ministry since 1983 after I finished my college. I told you, just came back from the Philippines in Palawan. You know, when during those days, 29 years ago, when we resided in Palawan, we want to come back again to the main island because it's just like an island of Patmos to all of us. Badly innocent because there's no other place. But you know what? The workers there are no longer fit in that way. Because I have seen how the Lord blessed the work. They have huge hospitals, the biggest hospital all over the whole island of Palawan. They have how many schools? The problem with the school is they don't have building. That's why I told them why don't we switch. We go to Tidewater and bring our children there. Their enrollment is exploding. Their church is growing up. I said, Lord, this is your Lord. Why am I sharing this one to you? God's work will be on the move. Whether we like it or not, it will be Because Jesus said, the harvest truly is great. Now God is just giving you and me a privilege to be a part of His witnesses. You know why? Because when Christ will come bring His people in His kingdom, we'll be our witnesses to what? Not in this earth. We're no longer witness in this world. Time is over. We'll be a witness to the universe, telling the fallen world the goodness of the Lord. What God had done to us, that we are all sinners, saved by grace, and we're willing to share. Amen. That's good news. This morning, we have seen the harvest truly is great. I want you to talk to your God today in a silent moment. Letting God open your eyes. And you can say, Lord, thank you for letting us see the harvest truly is great. Open your eyes that I may see that there are a lot of people waiting for us. Boys and girls, young men and women, educated and educated, rich and poor, waiting for us. Because you know the time is at hand. The harvest of the world is coming. And you and I are given the privilege to be a witness. Shall we spend time with moment of silence as we talk to our God today?
That's a typo.
Yeah, it's corrected now.
Here we go.